Dear students, let us continue our learning the course System Software and the Compilers. This is the 7th session of the Module 3. In this session, we are going to cover the topics from the chapter Syntax Analysis, that is Top-Down Parsing, Introduction to the Top-Down Parsing. Under that one, we will learn a Recursive Descent Parsing and Computation of a First and Follow. Myself, Dr. Suresh Adi from the Department of Computer Science and Engineering of Kendra Engineering College, Bantwal, Mangalore. To start with the top-down parsing. So as we stated earlier in the previous video, for the top-down parsing, the grammar is to be freed from the ambiguity, left recursion and the left factoring. So only after this one, we need to go for the top-down parsing. Fine? So the top-down parsing mainly works on the concept of your pre-order, that is our depth-first search. Fine? That is, we start constructing the tree based on the pre-order or the depth first search. That is, top-down parsing will be viewed as in a leftmost derivation of an input string. Grammars what we use in this one, they are called as the LL set of grammars. LL stands for the first L stands for the scan from left to right, and the second L stands for the apply the leftmost derivation. Fine? How to apply this one? How the top-down parsing works on this grammar? Let us see. Fine? So this is the grammar what we have obtained after removing the left recursion over there. In the previous video, we have seen how to eliminate the left recursion from the arithmetic grammar. So from after that one, this is the resultant grammar what we have obtained. So now let us go for constructing the tree for ID plus ID star ID. Now let us see how this tree will be constructed. So first we start with the E. For E have only one option, that is a T E dash. E D is a T E dash. Fine. So now what we have, the first operator? The first operator is plus. Before that one, I have the ID. How to get ID? Where is our ID? ID is in the F. Now where is F? Where is the F? There is a question again. So where is the F? F is in the here. You can look. F is in the here. So now to get that F, I need that T. So now where is T? T is here. That is a T derives. Now we need to go for T derives. F T dash. F T dash. Then this F derives ID. So I got the first ID over there. So this ID I got. So now after that one, I need the plus. Where is plus? Plus is present in the E dash. So now where is E dash? E dash is here. So before that E dash, if you have anything, so now those things ought to be mapped with epsilon. So now for the T dash, I have the epsilon. So T dash derives epsilon. T dash derives epsilon. Then next, for the E dash. For E dash, what is the next one we need to have? Plus. That is E dash derives. So now if you look at the E dash over there, what is that one? The first one is a plus. Next one is a T. Next one is E dash. So now I mapped ID and I mapped plus. What is the next thing over there? It is again ID over there. So now how to get ID? ID is present in the F. So from T I need to get the F. How to get F from the T? That is T derives F T dash. So T derives again F T dash. Now F derives ID. So now I got the next one. What is the next one over there? Next one is next ID I got. Then the next one is a star. Where is star is present? Star is present under the T dash. Do we have T dash after the ID? Yes, here we have. So for this T dash, what we will write? We write it as a star F T dash. Again, this F derives ID. Now what I got now? ID plus ID star ID. So I done with it. Rest of the things we will initiate with the, we have the production of Z epsilon over there. So now this is the tree. this is the prefix. Right? The constructing of this one is our top-down parsing. That is, it will start from our root symbol. So now if you observe, we start from the E. We start from the root symbol, and depending on our input, so what was our input? Input was ID plus ID star ID. So depending on our input, so we keep on applying the derivation over there. Which derivation we have applied? Always we keep on applying the leftmost derivation is applied. That is your top down parsing is a completely in the mechanism of applying the leftmost derivation over there. That is scan from left to right, that is our first L, and apply the leftmost derivation depending on our input. Now let us take one other example. For the same grammar, let us take the other example over there, how it will be applied. Fine. So now let me erase this one. Let the grammar be, it is open parenthesis ID plus ID, close parenthesis, next will be the star, next will be the ID. If you have the production of this format, how it will be applied? Always we have to start with the E. We'll start with the E. So now what is the option for the E? I have the option of T E dash over there. For the E, I have the only option as T E dash. T E dash, right? Then next, again for the T, if I go with the T, for the T, I have the option of only the F T dash. For the T, I have the option of having the F T dash. Always we should go for applying the leftmost non-terminal. You can look over here which one I am applying. Even though I have the two options over there, one is T, other is the E dash, I have selected with the T over here. What is the T? T is our leftmost non-terminal. T is our leftmost non-terminal which we are applying. Now the F derives. What is the F over there? It is a open parenthesis, expression is E, and the close parenthesis over there. So now I got the open and the closing. In between that one, I have something. What is that one? ID plus ID, which I need to generate over here. T derives F T dash. Now again for the E, I need to generate ID plus ID. How to get? So for the E, it is E derives T E dash. Then T derives F T dash. F T dash. Then this F derives, ID. Now what I got? Open parenthesis done. Then ID done. Now what I have? Plus. So now that plus is present under E dash. Now what to do for this T dash? So T dash I will put it as the epsilon. T dash I will put it as the epsilon. In place of plus, if I have the star over there, then for that T dash I will substitute the star over there. What is that one? Star F T dash. Since after ID I have the plus, so this T dash I will put it as the epsilon. Now for the E dash. For the E dash, I need the plus. So it is a plus T and the E dash. So now I got the plus. After plus, what I need? ID. So I need to get ID from the T. So what is that one? T derives F T dash. Then F derives ID. F will give me the ID over there. So now what I have done? Open parenthesis ID plus ID, and the close parenthesis is already done. So in between that one, I have T dash and the E dash. That I will put it as a epsilon over there. Because it is not needed, I will put it as a epsilon. So now after that, so now till here I have done, what is next? Star ID. Where is star? Star is present under the T dash. So now where is our T dash? After parenthesis, closing parenthesis, here I have the T dash. For this T dash, I will substitute the star F T dash. Again, this F will derive me the ID. So I done with the I open parenthesis ID plus ID, close parenthesis, star ID. So now still I have the two more non-terminals, T dash and the E dash. You make the epsilon over there. T dash derives epsilon and E dash derives epsilon. This is how your top down parsing will work. So we started with the root. So what was our root? That is our start symbol. We started with our start symbol and we are able to obtain our input. We are able to obtain our input one at a time. Which non-terminal we are substituting every time? The leftmost non-terminal we are substituting every time. The leftmost non-terminal we are substituting every time. Fine. So this is an approach what we follow in the top-down parsing. This is the approach what we follow in the top-down parsing. So while doing this top-down parsing, there are many variants are there. So some variants they are going to use the backtracking is used. So this backtracking you learnt already in your earlier semester. But again, let me tell you. Suppose for the A, I have the two options over there. So the first one derives AB. Second one derives C. AB or the just B over there. So now I have the two options over there for the A. Either it can be AB or the B. So now what I will do? I will first try with this one. If it works out, it's fine. If not, I will backtrack and again go back to this A and I will substitute the B. This is what our backtracking is. When a non-terminal derives more than one production and if the first production body is not matching, then we will try for the second production over there. That mechanism we call it as the backtracking. So here, there are two variants are there in the top-down parsing. In the first variant, we call it as a recursive descent parsing, which need backtracking, which may need the backtracking. And the second one is our predictive parsing, so wherein backtracking is not needed. So in case of predictive parsing, we won't use the backtracking. But in case of recursive descent parsing, we use the backtracking. Okay? So now this is the same thing what I explained right now, how we constructed the we started with our non-terminal, that is our root start symbol E. We keep on applying one production, one leftmost derivation at a time. LM stands for the leftmost derivation. We keep on applying the leftmost derivation one at a time. So till we get our complete input. Our complete input is ID plus ID star ID and the rest we are putting it as epsilon over there. That is, this top-down parsing is a mechanism of applying leftmost derivation, scanning from left to right and applying the leftmost derivation over there. So that will be your basics for the top-down parsing. The class of grammars what we use in the top-down parsing, we call it as the LL grammars. LL of 1 we are going to write. So LL of 1. What is this LL of 1? That is the question always. The first L stands for scan from left to right. So the first L stands for scan from left to right. The scanning will happen from left to right, not from right to left. The scanning will happen from left to right. Then next, the second L. The second L stands for apply the leftmost derivation. The second L stands for the apply the leftmost derivation over there. Then what is that one over there again? What is that? One. One stands for the look ahead. One character look ahead. One token of look ahead. So how many tokens of look ahead? Means one token of look ahead. Means looking at the next token, we will make the decision. By looking at the next token, we will make the decision over there. That is, it will be your LL of K class, where the first L will be scan from left to right. Apply the leftmost derivation. K symbols of look ahead. K symbols of look ahead we are going to apply. So for this mechanism, as I told in the top-down parsing, we learn the two different approaches. The first one is a recursive descent parsing. Other one is the predictive parsing. In the recursive descent parsing, use a concept of backtracking. Where in the predictive parsing, we construct a table and depending on that table, we will make the decisions. For the construction of that table, we need to learn the generation of first and the follow set. So we have an algorithm for that computation. We will learn one by one. Fine. So now first let us start with our first mechanism, that is our recursive descent parsing. Fine. So now in the recursive descent parsing, this is the first mechanism of the top-down parsing. How it will work? Let us take the example of E derives T E dash. E derives T E dash. So now E for each non-terminal, there will be a function will be there. There will be a procedure. So that is void. What is the non-terminal? That is our E. So under E, so we have the two more non-terminal. For each non-terminal is nothing but one function. Each non-terminal is a function. For the E, what is the first thing? That is our T. I will call the function T. Again, for the E dash, I will call the function E dash. E dash is one more non-terminal. I will call the function E dash. This will be the body of the production. Let us go with the E dash over there. So what is our E dash? E dash is a E dash derives. E dash derives plus T E dash. E dash derives plus T E dash or the epsilon. Now you have the two options. If the input symbol is, now again for the function E dash, I will start with the void. Void E dash. Fine. So now I have the two options over here. So now for the E dash, I have the two options. So I will go with the first production. I will go with the first production. If it fails, then I will go back and I will apply the second one. That is the thing. If we fail with that one, it uses a concept of backtracking. So if it fails, then we will go back and we will apply the second one. What is our second one? That is epsilon. So here, yeah, first case, I will go with the first production over there. How many such cases, how many productions are there, how many things? We have the two options over there. I have the two options. So I will go with the first option over there. Then the first option, I will check for the terminal. What is the terminal? If my symbol is plus, then I will call the function T. Then I will call the function E dash. If my first symbol is not plus, if my first symbol is not plus, then I will check whether it is empty. Else, I will check whether it is empty. That is the second option. Fine. That is, I will try for the first option. If I fail, then I will go back. I will go back and I will apply the second one. Fine. So that will be your recursive descent parsing. That is, in the recursive descent parsing, for each non-terminal, one procedure will be there. For each non-terminal, one procedure will be there. How it will work? Let us look at a simple procedure for it. Let A be the non-terminal. That is, we start with the void A. We select the production. A derives x1, x2 up to xk half. Fine. So in this case, that is E dash derives plus T E dash plus T E dash. So in this case, how many things are there? 1, 2, and 3. This is our x1, first symbol. This is my x2, second symbol. This is my x3, the third symbol. These are the options. Fine. So now, in this case, that is, I will take the length of it. I will try for the first option. But the length over here, 3. That value of k will be equal to 3. Value of k will be equal to 3. So now, x will take the value from 1 to 3. 1 to 3. First, I will check the first one. If it is a terminal, what is the terminal? Plus. If it matches with our input symbol A, advance to the next symbol. Go to the next symbol. After x1, what we have? x2. Go to the next symbol. Advance the input to the next symbol. If it is a non-terminal, then for each non-terminal, one function will be written. That is, if xi is a non-terminal, then you call that procedure. If it is a terminal, then you match with the current input symbol. If not, then it is an error. If it won't match with any of them, if it is a non-terminal, you call that function. If it is a terminal, it should match with our input symbol, or else it is an error. This is how your recursive descent parsing work. Simple mechanism. So in the recursive descent parsing, what are the key features over there? The key feature is, the recursive descent parsing is an application of backtracking. That you have to remember. So in this backtracking, what happens? We first select the first production. If it has three things over there on the body of the production, 3, 4, it can be of any k length. Now for each symbol, we have the different option. It can be a non-terminal or it can be a terminal. If it is a non-terminal, then we are going to call the procedure, because for each non-terminal, we have written one procedure. For each non-terminal, we have written a procedure. That procedure we will call if it is a non-terminal. If it is a terminal, then it should match with our input. If it is a terminal, then it should match with our input. If it matches with our input, you go to the next symbol. If it is a terminal but it is not matching, in that case, it is a meaning that an error has occurred. Give the error message. Fine. So this is how the recursive descent parsing will work. So it's an application of your backtracking over there. Fine. So now let us take this example. Our grammar is S derives C A D, and A derives A B or the A. Fine. So now if my input is C A D, my W is my string. So W is a C A D. How this will work? Simple. First, what happens? We start from the S. So for the S, I have the only one option. What is that one? C A D. So that is C A and the D. So now this C is matched with this one. Done. Fine. Input symbol is matched with the terminal symbol. Done. So now I have the non-terminal A. So now you call the function A. So now for the A, what is the option? First option, it is A B. It is the A and the B. So now again, A and the A, there is a match. Done. Next, D and the B. So here there is a mismatch. Here it is a mismatch. Now what we will do? We will backtrack. We will remove it and we try for the, other option. What is that other option? That is your A derives A. So that is the other option. So now we will remove it. We will backtrack and we will go with the other option. What is the other option? A derives A. Now A and the A, there is a match. D and the D, there is a match. So we are able to generate the tree. So this is how your recursive descent parsing works. It is a simple top-down parsing. Recursive descent parsing is a simple top-down parsing, and it is an application of backtracking. The drawback with the recursive descent parsing is backtracking. So in many a time, if we keep on doing this backtracking, now the length is 2 and we have only 2 productions over there, it's fine. Assume that it has some 50 productions over there. How many times will we backtrack? That is again a big hurdle. It's again a big problem over there in the implementation. So that's why normally recursive descent parsing is not preferred. Even though we have the concept of recursive descent parsing, but it is not preferred over there. Fine. So now whatever I explained right now, it is the same thing has been written over there. First we try for the first option, that is A derives AB. Now we fail over here. Then we will go back and I will apply the second set. Second one is A derives A. So now it is a successful one. So we are able to generate. That is it is an application of your backtracking. Fine. That is a recursive descent parsing is an application of a backtracking. Fine. Why it happened? Let me go back and let us try to analyze. So what we have? S derives C, A and the D. And A derives A, B or the A. A derives A, B or the A. Fine. So now in this case, when my input, now if you observe this grammar carefully, now here I have a left factoring over there, if you observe. What is that left factoring? Here you can look. The common thing I have. What was my common thing? A. So now if I go for left factoring this one, how it should be? A derives small a, A dash, and the A dash derives B or the second one is epsilon. B or the epsilon. Fine. So now if for the single case it is fine. We are able to do the left factoring and we can do. Fine. But In many cases, this will lead into an infinite loop. We keep on trying about the different options, and it may lead into an infinite loop. So that is the reason why the backtracking is not preferred over there. Fine. That is, a left recursive grammar can cause a recursive descent parser to go to an infinite loop. It may go into an infinite loop. So henceforth, it is not recommended. It is a theoretical concept which will fit well over there. So for the top-down parsing, most commercially applicable top-down parsing is our predictive parsing. For the cases of predictive parsing, we need to generate the first and the follow set. How the first and the follow set is generated? So that is the thing. Fine. For generating the first and the follow set, we have the two algorithms over there. Fine. So let us see these algorithms. First, for the generation of the first set. These first and the follow set is needed in both your top down parsing as well as the bottom up parsing. In both the cases, we need the calculation of the first and the follow. So now let us learn how to calculate the first. Fine. For the calculation of the first, let us take the example over here. So let us take again our arithmetic expression example. So what was our arithmetic expression example? E derives T E dash plus T E dash or the epsilon, then T derives F T dash, and the T dash derives star F T dash or the epsilon, then F derives open E and the close or the ID. So now let me, this is the grammar. Fine. So let us look how many non-terminals I have. So this is our grammar, and let us look how many non-terminals we have. Fine. So now here, whatever the compound things was there, so let me rewrite them separately over there. E dash derives plus T E dash or epsilon was there. So let me write it as E dash derives epsilon separately over there. E dash derives epsilon. In the same way for the T dash of the merged one, so let me write it as a T dash derives epsilon. Now in the same way for the F, I have the two productions over here. Let me write it as a F derives ID. So whatever our earlier conventions were there, now that one I am just expanding it. Earlier it was plus T E dash or the epsilon. For the epsilon I have written E dash derives epsilon. For the T dash it was a star F T dash or the epsilon. So again I have rewritten as a T dash derives epsilon. For the F it was open E close or the ID. I have written it as F derives ID. Now we will go for calculating the first set. Fine. For the calculation of the first set, how many non-terminals are? I have the 5 non-terminals over there. What are those? E, E dash, T, T dash, and the F. So I will write them separately over there. That is first of the first non-terminal was E equal to, I will open the brace. The second non-terminal was E dash. Then the next one was T. Next one was T dash. And the next one is F. So I need to find the first of these non-terminals. First case, if X is a non-terminal, if X is a terminal, fine, for finding the first of the X, if X is a terminal over there, fine, that is, while looking calculation of the first, we look at the right side over there. For the E, what is there in the right side? I have the plus T E dash. Here, that is for the E, I have the T over here, right? So for the E, I have the T. Now for the E dash, what do you have in the first? I have the plus over there. For the E dash, I have the plus. If I consider this one, if I consider the second one, what I have? I have the epsilon. That is, if it is a terminal, you include it. If it is a epsilon production, you include it. These are the two cases. If it is a non-terminal, then we need to do some operation that I will explain. I have written the non-terminal directly. So let me handle these cases. For the T, what I have in the T? For the T, I have the F in the right side. The first of T is F. Then for the T dash, where is our T dash? Here. What is the first over there? Look at the body over there. Write the first production. What is that one? Star. So I will write the star over there. Then one more is here. If I consider this one, I have the epsilon. I will write the epsilon here. Next, for the F, first of F, where is F? Here, till here. So what is the first of F? If I take up this one, this is open parenthesis. If it is a terminal, we have to write it directly. Then one more is ID. ID we are going to write. Fine. So now look again. So now for these cases, for E dash, T dash and the F, we got. For E dash, what is this one? Plus or the epsilon. For the T dash, what it is? A star and the epsilon. For the F, it is open parenthesis and the ID. That we will write it directly. Fine. So now let us look at handling the non-terminal. If X is a non-terminal. That is, if the production is like this, X derives Y1, Y2 up to YK. Now what to do? Fine. So if first of X is a Y, then you need to take the first of Y. If it is till you get that terminus, you have to repeat. First of E. What is first of E? T. What is first of T? First of T is F. What is first of F? First of F is open and ID. That will be substituted for the where that F we need. Where we F we need, here we have the F. So now in place of this F, we write the first of the F over there. What is the first of the F? First of the F is open and the ID. Open and the ID will be written here. Fine. Again, first of here, T we have done. So next we need to go where the T is needed. Where it is, the first of E is was our T. So now into this place, we are going to write the first of the T. What is the first of the T over there? It is again open parenthesis and the ID. So this is how we calculate the first set. Fine. So let me brief it out. For calculating the first over there, so if X is a terminal, you directly add as a cases of plus, star, open parenthesis and ID. These are all terminals. You directly add them. If X is a terminal, you directly add to the first set. Fine. Second case. Third case. If X is epsilon, if X derives epsilon is a production, then you add that epsilon to the first of the X. You add the epsilon to the first set over there. If not, then the question mark again. If X is a non-terminal over there, in this case, here, T, in here, the first of the E is the T over there. It is a non-terminal. So when it is a non-terminal over there, so you need to take the first of the T. First of the T is again F. Again, you need to take the first of the F. What is the first of the F? First of the F is open parenthesis and the ID. That will be substituted to the first of the T. That will be substituted to the first of the E. If this has epsilon, assume. first of f, if it has a epsilon with id, if I have epsilon also over there, let us assume that I have one more production called, let us assume that I have one more production f derives epsilon. How it will work? Let us assume here it is not there, but let us learn all the different possibilities. If we have a production called f derives epsilon is also there, so now to the first of f I will add up the epsilon. Now we again go back and do this one, fine. So now first e derives t e dash, t derives f t dash, f derives open id and the epsilon. So now when I go for finding the first of the f we have done, first of the t, what is first of the t? First of the t is our f. So now when we go for solving this one, so now here what I have, open I will put directly, id I will put directly, then next one, what is it, this one, if I put epsilon here, what happens, t derives f t dash, here if I substitute the epsilon, so what will be left out? Epsilon means what? Nothing, it will cancels. What is left out? T dash. Now I need to write the first of the t dash over there. What is the first of the t dash? First of the t dash will be our star and epsilon again. If I put the epsilon, everything cancels. Then I need to write the epsilon. So this one you need to remember. If it is a non-terminal, for terminal and if it is directly giving the epsilon, you can directly write, no problem at all, it's good. But if it is a non-terminal, in this case, first of t is f is a non-terminal, I need to take the first of the f. What is the first of the f? Open id and the epsilon. Epsilon don't write directly, you substitute here. If I put the epsilon here, then this cancels. I will be visible with the t dash over there. Now I need to write the first of the t dash. What is the first of the t dash? Star I will write. Again, if I put epsilon, nothing is there. Then I will write the epsilon. Then I am going to write the epsilon. This is how I will, in the same way, for the e derives t e dash. So for this one, again it will be the same thing. So now when I put the t, for the t what I have? For the t it is open id and the star I am going to write. Now epsilon if I substitute, what will I get? E dash. I got the first of the e dash. What is the first of the e dash? Plus and the epsilon. So plus I will write directly and that epsilon if I substitute, so the whole thing cancels. Now I left out with the epsilon, then I will write the epsilon. Fine. So this you should be careful while generating the first set. So while generating the first set, what all we have to be careful? The first one, we look at the, for each non-terminal, we write the each non-terminal here. We look at the body of the production. If it is a terminal, if the first symbol is a terminal, that terminal will be directly written. That symbol will be directly written. Finished. If it is epsilon, that is I have a production called x derives epsilon, then to the first of the x I will include that epsilon. In this case, e dash derives epsilon, for the e dash epsilon will be included. T dash derives epsilon, for the t dash epsilon is included. It will be directly included. But when it is a non-terminal, in this case e derives t e dash, in these cases you should be careful. So now in this case what I will do, I will take the first of the t. First of the t is f. First of the f, open id and the epsilon. So open and the id I will directly write. Open and the id directly write. But if I put the epsilon, then t dash is visible. When t dash is visible, I will take the first of the t dash. What is the first of the t dash? Means if I put epsilon here, t dash is visible. Take the first of t dash. What is that one? Star. I will write. Again epsilon I will substitute. So everything cancels. This is also epsilon. This is also epsilon. Means nothing is left out. Then I will write the epsilon here. Fine. So that procedure we follow for generating the first symbol over there. This is the procedure what we follow for generating the first symbol. Now let us go for learning how we will generate the follow set. Let us learn how to generate the follow set. Before that one, let me erase the extra things whatever we have added. So the extra thing what we have added is a f derives epsilon, this we have added. So because of which we are getting this one. So this I will remove. This I will remove. And this I will remove. Fine. So now this is my solution for my expression grammar. So now we learned the generation of the Now we learned the generation of the first set. So always you have to start with the first set. Then next, for generating the follow set. For generating the follow set. Again, for the follow of all the five non-terminals, I need to find follow of. Follow of, what and all I need? I need the follow of E, E dash, T, T dash, and the F. I need to find the follow of E, follow of E dash, follow of T dash, follow of the T dash, and the follow of the F I need to find. First, for finding the follow set, so if it is a star symbol, so now in this production, which is the star symbol over here? E. So for that one, by default, you add the terminal dollar. First step. What is the first step? For the follow set of the star symbol, you add the dollar. For the follow set of the star symbol, you add the dollar over there. So dollar is added. Next. Next step. Fine. So I need to find the follow of E. So now don't look at the root of the production. You search for E in the right side over here. In the body of the production, you search. Wherever E is there in the body of the production, you search it. So where is E? Do we have the E here? No. What we have? TE dash. Here. TE dash. Here. Epsilon. Here. FT dash. Here. FT dash. Here. Epsilon. Here I have the E. Take the next to the E. What is next to the E? Close parenthesis. That will be the follow of the E. Follow means who is following me next? That is the one. Fine. So E is present over here. In the next symbol, take the first of it. From the after E, whatever it is there, take the first of it. What is the first of it? That is the close parenthesis. That will be written. Fine. So anywhere else does the E is present? Nowhere else E is present. Then I will close it. This is the follow of E. Next, follow of E dash. Search where that E dash is present. Where E dash is present? Here it is present. Do we have something next to E? No. When we don't have anything next to it, if you look at this place, I don't have anything. When I don't have anything, then take its root. What is the root of it? E. Take the follow of it. What is the follow of its root? Root is our E. Take the follow of the E. What is the follow of the E? Follow the E is a dollar and the close parenthesis. This is somewhat confusing. You should be careful. Follow of E dash will be the dollar and the close parenthesis. Now again, let us go with the next one. In the next one, I need to find the follow of the T. So now where is T? T is present here. What is next to this one? I have next to this one is my E dash. Take the first of the E dash. What is the first of the E dash? Plus and the epsilon. Plus I will write. Don't write the epsilon. So plus I will write. If I substitute epsilon. What happens? This cancels. When it cancels, when nothing is left to it, what to do? Take the follow of its root. What is its root? E. Take the follow of it. What is the follow of it? Follow of E is a closing parenthesis and the dollar. Fine. So now search where T is present in some other places. Again, here it is present. What is next to it? E dash. Take the first of E dash. What is the first of E dash? Plus. Write the plus. It is already there. If nothing is there, take the follow of the root. What is the follow of the root? Follow of E dash is your closing and the dollar over there. So this will be the follow of the T. Next case, follow of T dash. Search where T dash is present. Here it is the T dash. What is next to it? Nothing. When we don't have anything next to it, what to do? Take the follow of its root. What is the root over there? T. Take the follow of it. What is the follow of the T? The follow of the T is a plus closing and the dollar. Then next, where is T dash again? T dash again, it is present over here. But the follow of it, nothing. Take the follow of its root. Root is your plus closing and the dollar. Done. Then next, F. Search where F is present on the right side. Where F is present, here F. We have the F. What is next to it? T dash. take the first of the T dash, but the first of the T dash, star and the epsilon, you just write the star. Epsilon don't write in the follow set, remember, epsilon will not come in the follow set, always. If you substitute the epsilon over here, what happens? This cancels. When it cancels, nothing is there next to the F. What to do? Take the follow of its root. When nothing is there next to it, you need to take the follow of the root. If something is there, you have to take the first of it. If something is there after F, I have something. What I have? T dash. Take the first of it. First of it is star. If I put the epsilon, this cancels. Next to F, I don't have anything because epsilon. Epsilon means it cancelled. Then in that case, you need to take the follow of the root. What is the follow of the root? That is your plus closing and the dollar. Then close. So this will be my follow set. This is how we construct the first and the follow set. It is very important. The construction of the first and follow set is very important in the top down and the bottom up parsing. And it is very easy also. It is very important and it is very easy. So now if we summarize the steps, what and all we have done. If we summarize that one. Fine. For the first calculation, what we have done? If it is first calculation, we look at here. First of E, E dash, T, T dash and the F. We look at the body of the production. If it is a terminal, you directly write. First of E dash plus, directly write. If it derives epsilon, directly write. If it is a terminal and epsilon, you directly write. If it is a non-terminal, then you take the first of it. For the E, first is a T. Go to the T. First is F. Go to the F. I have the open parenthesis and the ID. That will be written. That is written for both the T and the E. If it has epsilon, means you need to go to the next symbol. If it is epsilon, means you need to go to the next symbol. If even that is epsilon, go to the next symbol. If you get epsilon for all, only then you have to write the epsilon over there. Only then you have to write the epsilon. So that will be the computation of the first set. Then next, for the calculation of the follow set. If it is a star symbol, then you add the dollar. You add the dollar. So in this case, E is our star symbol. So you add the dollar. That is a place dollar in the follow of the S, where S is the star symbol. Next cases. You search for that non-terminal in the right side. So you search for E in the right side. Where is E? Here. Here I have the VE. What is next to E? You need to take the first of it. After E, whatever it is there, you need to take the first of it. What is next to it? It is a close parenthesis. Take the first of it. The first is your close parenthesis. Fine. So now if we have something, we take the first of it. If we don't have anything, then you need to take the follow of its root. Then you need to take the follow of its root. Next one, E dash. E dash, if I look, search for E dash over there. Where is E dash? Here I have the E dash. I don't have anything next to it. What to do? Take the follow of its root. What is the root? E. Take the follow of it. What is the follow of it? Dollar and the close parenthesis. Dollar and the close parenthesis. Again, the same way. T. What is next to it? After T, what I have? E dash. Take the first of E dash. What is the first of E dash? Plus and the epsilon. Plus I will write. If I substitute epsilon, this cancels. When it cancels, take the follow of its root. What is the follow of the root? E dash. What is the follow of it? Close parenthesis and the dollar. Then in the same way, T dash, nothing is there. Take the follow of its root. It is a plus, close parenthesis and the dollar. Then F, where is F? Here I have the F. What is next to it? T dash, take the first of it. First of T dash is your star and the epsilon. I just write the star. When it is epsilon, then you need to take the follow of the root. What is the follow of the root? T, that is a plus, close parenthesis and the dollar. This is how we will find the first and the follow set. It is very important. If you are able to find the first and the follow set, then the rest will be the quite simple. So now the first and the follow set is how it is calculated, we have explained. What is this one? Now the first one is put dollar in the follow set of the star symbol. And if you have the production of this format, A derives alpha, B, beta, then follow of the B will be the first of the beta. That is, first of the beta will come to the follow of B, except epsilon. If we get epsilon, means if this cancels, then we will take the follow of the A. That is, follow of A will be put into the follow of the B. Okay? This you have to remember in calculating the first and the follow set. And this is the result what we have obtained and what we have discussed. That is, the first of E will be equal to first of T, equal to first of F, that is open and ID. First of E dash is plus and the epsilon. First of T dash is a star and the epsilon. Then the follow of E and the E dash is a closing and the dollar. T and the T dash is a plus, closing and the dollar. and the F is a plus star closing under dot. Fine. So this is how we will calculate the first and the follow set, and I hope it is clear. I hope it is clear. If you have any doubt, you are free to mail me at any point of time, so that I will be very happy to clear your doubts. So in this presentation, we learned two different approaches in the top-down parsing, that is a recursive descent parsing and the predictive parsing. So for the predictive parsing, just we learned the construction of the first and the follow set. How the table will be built up, that we will discuss in the next class. Fine. So now for applying the top-down parsing, you should be aware that we need to eliminate the ambiguity, we need to eliminate the left recursion, we need to go for left factoring. And with that one, in case of recursive descent parsing, it uses the backtracking. Whereas the predictive parsing, we need to construct the table, that we will discuss in the next video. Fine. The references for this presentation are taken from the textbook. Alfred V. Ho, Monica S. Lam, Ravi Sethi and Jeffrey D. Ullman are the authors. The name of the textbook is Compilers, Principles, Techniques and the Tools. It's in Pearson Publication, 2nd edition, 2007. Thank you.